This is going to be a long one, but I promise, 100% guarantee or your money back, it'll be worth it. First, there will be no math in this episode. I'm going to show you equations, but I'm not going to be doing math with them. I'm not going to be manipulating them. I'm going to be explaining them. They're like illustrations. Now, anyone who knows even a little bit about reinforcement learning and neural network AI probably looked at the title of this video and started yelling at their computer screen, "What are you doing? You've barely done two videos discussing the overall idea of AI. You haven't discussed any of the basic concepts, and you're jumping straight into Sarsa? What about all the theory, the derivation? What about tabular methods and backpropagation and linear rectification? Stochastic gradient descent, Monte Carlo, the multi-arm bandlet? What about any of it? Ah!" First of all, you don't need a neural network to make a reinforcement learning trained AI. You're going to use one for anything serious because a neural network is efficient, works really well. But if you want to make something extremely simple, a little toy one, you can use a pen and paper. You can use MATLAB. You can use a spreadsheet program. I read an article about somebody that used toothpicks or matchsticks or something to make one. That's real. Neural networks are just the better way to do it, not the necessary way to do it. So I'm not going to be talking about neural networks today. Furthermore, this channel is a different kind of learning. This is not a classroom. This is a very specific and special way to learn, where instead of building you up, the way that a textbook, a classroom works is you start with some sort of basic fundamental, like 1 plus 1 equals 2, and you build and build and build and build and build, like you're building a house. And you very slowly, but very efficiently, get where you're going. I do it different. I reach right into the problem, grab a piece of it, and say, here, grab this too. I give you a handle. We don't need the theory, we don't need the derivation, we don't need the history, we don't need relations to other fields of research and science. We don't need everything that led up to the development of this. I'm going to give you a piece, and you hold on to that piece, and you will understand this piece. This video is long, partly because I'm blathering on at the start, but partly because it is not short and quick to explain easy. Easy is not quick. Simple is not quick. But by the end of this, you will be able to make an AI. A small one, but a real one. This Sarsa is not a toy algorithm. If you take any computer programming and you start to learn sorting algorithms, what's the first thing they ever teach you is bubble sort. Nobody uses bubble sort. Bubble sort is stupid. Bubble sort is good for learning. And then as soon as you learn it and move on, you throw it away. Bubble sort is a joke made for a classroom. Sarsa is real. Sarsa is used by companies and research labs all over the place right this second. They use fancy Sarsa with all kinds of bells and whistles and blinking lights, but it's still Sarsa. There are other algorithms that aren't Sarsa, Q-learning and such, but the thing about Sarsa is it's uniquely suited for this channel. It's the bread and butter, meat and potatoes, one size fits most algorithm. Sarsa cannot do everything, but it can do almost everything to varying degrees of success. It's your bell curve. You know, you've got your bell curve. Sarsa is that big old chunk in the middle of the bell curve, and it's bad at the edges. The edges are where other algorithms that are more experimental come in. Sarsa is, relatively speaking, tried and true, well-known. Sarsa is the safe option and the easy option. And most importantly of all, it is the general option. You're going to be using the same exact Sarsa algorithm for every type of learning you do. You specify the reward function. We've gone over this. I'll go over it again. You specify the reward function. You specify the inputs and outputs. But the learning is all the same every time. Until we get to those bells, whistles, and blinking lights, of course. So that's more than enough blathering on. It's time for the whiteboard. Sarsa. It's actually not a person's name this time. It's an acronym, or initialism if you prefer. It stands for State, Action, Reward. State, action, reward. State, action, reward. State, action, reward. This is the sequence that the training goes through to make the AI work. And it's also the sequence that the AI goes through to actually evaluate what it's doing. The only difference between training and running the thing once you've trained it is whether or not its values are adjusted based on the result of each step. That's all training is. You evaluate the network, and if you're training it, you correct it. Otherwise, you just run it. Think of your AI, your neural network, or whatever, as a black box. You have inputs. These inputs are whatever you want. They're numbers, just real numbers, floating point numbers in computing. It's just numbers. These numbers mean whatever you want them to mean. They represent what the AI sees. It senses, its eyes, its ears, its probes, whatever. The input is what you give it to work with. You decide what to give it. You have to give it what it needs to be able to accomplish the goal, but you don't want to give it too much because then there's just a lot of unnecessary stuff it has to weed out. So, input is what you give it. The output is what you want out of it. Again, you define what this is, they're just numbers. It could be which move to make, it could be which voltage to apply to a sensor, it could be anything. When you are training the AI, you give it inputs, it gives you a result, and you get outputs. When you're training it, you correct those outputs because you know what the answer should be. And you correct it by giving it its reward signal. Just like training a dog. If you tell the dog to sit and it sits, you give it a biscuit. If you tell the dog to sit and it poops on the carpet, you yell at it and waggle your finger or whatever. However you train your dog. But it's the same thing. You give it inputs, you get outputs, and then you the person, you the controller of this AI, decide if it's good or bad. The AI has no concept of good and bad results. The AI only knows its reward signal, and it knows it wants to maximize its reward signal, because that's how we set up the math. If you decide these outputs were good for these inputs, you give it a reward. If you decide these outputs were bad for this input, you give it a penalty, negative reward. Or you could give it nothing. If you give it zero, then it just carries on trying to get reward further down the line. When you're training, you use the reward to reinforce, hence the name, to encourage it to do what it just did again. Whatever it just did, you said that's good, so it's going to try and do it again. In the same situation, it's going to try and do the same thing. If you give it a penalty, it's going to try and do that less. That's all it is. It's just like a dog. It wants more biscuits, and it doesn't want to be yelled at. What is in the black box? Just math. You can implement it in a billion different ways, so we're not going to worry about it now. It's just math. So now the fun part. I'm going to write some equations on the board, and I'm going to read them out as I write them. They're going to be gobbledygook to you. I'm just going to have them up there so that I can refer to them and explain them piece by piece. We have a small, a medium, and a large. And as to my notation, everybody uses different notation. I've looked around. Sutton and Bartow use notation. These guys use notation. Everybody uses different notation, so I'm picking the ones I like. That's one sad thing about math is oftentimes, you know, we can agree on plus, but what does this mean? You're just going to have to look it up. So here's the medium one. The value for a state at time step t and the action taken in time step t equals the expected reward, that's a backwards r, the expected reward at time step t plus 1 plus, I'm terrible at writing that letter, don't worry about it, the discounted value when you're in state t plus 1 taking action t plus 1. I'm trying to make my t's and pluses look different. So that's 1. Now for the little one. The policy, that's supposed to be pi, the policy given the state at the current time step t and the value function equals the action to be taken at time step t. Now the fun one. This is going to be a two-liner. The value at state t with action t, its new value, prime, so the new result, the new value, equals the old value. So the new value starts with the value it already is, plus the learning rate, that's supposed to be an alpha, the learning rate times, and it'll be times everything I write in here, which is just down here, all of this, the actual result, reward, that's a forward r, the actual reward at t plus 1, plus the discounted value at t plus 1, state in action at t plus 1, minus the current value. So that's a load of nonsense. And before I wrote it up here, I was hoping I'd have some space left. So I'm going to have to get rid of some of it to be able to write. But I'm just going to point out the pieces I'm about to explain. We have q is a value function, s is a state, and a is an action. There's our Sarsa. T is a time step. So you can have states and actions at different time steps. The backwards r is expected reward. The forwards r is actual reward. This is directly given by the user. This is what the AI thinks is in there. What's supposed to be a gamma, if you'll take my word for it, is the discount rate. Alpha, there's alpha. Alpha is the learning rate. And pi is the policy. So now let me go over what all of those things are. If all of that just flew right over your head, don't even worry about it. Just remember what it looked like. So let's start very simply. What is t? T is a time step. It's not time. It's not the clock time. It's a time step. Discrete time steps. It starts at 0, goes to 1, 2, 3, and so forth. all the way down to capital T, or infinity. What is a time step? Well, think about a chess game. Let's say you have your AI and you're trying to get it to learn to play chess. Now, a human mind never stops. A human mind is a continuous blob of everything. When it's your turn, you're thinking about what move to make, and you make a move. And the moment you make a move, you can't do anything else. You have to wait for the opponent to make a move. But you're thinking about what the opponent might be doing. You're looking at their face to see if there's any telltale signs. You're thinking about what you want for dinner. You're trying to think if there's any discreet way so you don't embarrass yourself to scratch your butt because it itches. An AI isn't doing all of this. An AI is focused, laser focused. So an AI literally has nothing to do, assuming it's not got a camera trying to analyze facial expressions. Let's not get that complicated. Let's say it's just making moves in chess. It makes a move, and it has literally nothing to do until the opponent makes a move. The key here is input. Remember how I had that black box with input and output? You have to have new input to receive new output. Even if your AI has memory, memory is just output that wraps around to input, right? You input something and then you remember it, and in the future, to use it again, you just put it out and back in again in a circle. So however you look at it, you have inputs and you have outputs, and the outputs depend on the inputs. If you don't change the input, you don't get a new output. So until the opponent makes the move, there is no new input. At the beginning of the game, if you're playing white, then time step zero is when you're about to make the first move of the game. If you're playing black, white has already made their move, and now you, playing black, are about to make your first move, the second move of the game. Time step zero is at the very first time you are giving the AI input and getting output. 1, 2, 3 is just the next time you do that. Each time you give it different input to get different output is a time step. So when you're playing chess, it's each time you are deciding a move. What if you have a robot? Let's say you have a robot and it has motors and you're trying to go around the room with this robot. You're trying to have the robot go around the room, picking up empty coffee cups and throwing them away, and it also has to charge its battery and go into sleep mode when the office closes. Well, there's no discrete time steps here. There's no turns like for a board game. But there are limitations. Your sensors can give you a signal only so fast. Like an Arduino Uno, for example, if you have an analog in pin and you request what voltage is on that pin, it takes a certain amount of time for the capacitors and everything to figure out that voltage. It's not just instantly there. Reading a sensor takes a certain amount of time. Until that time has elapsed, you don't get your new input. You have to wait for your new input. So there's a time step. Every time you get a new set of input from your sensors could be a time step. You could also be limited by your processing power. This little coffee cup collecting robot is probably not going to have a huge battery. It's not going to have a giant processor. You're not going to have a 16-core Threadripper in there. So it's going to be able to process only so fast. So there's a natural limitation on its computing power that determines how far apart in time it can do a single input-output step. So that could be your time step. It's a number you pick based on technical limitations, but each one is a time step. What if you have a video game? What if you have an AI that's trying to play a video game? Well, if we just worry about visuals, let's not worry about audio right now. That's much more complicated. But for video, there's a frame. You draw on the screen. If you don't know how video works, you draw on the screen, you present an image. The computer presents an image to you, and that's a frame. And then there's a certain amount of time, such as 30, 50, 60 times a second, so a 30th, a 50th, a 60th, or whatever, of a second between the frame you have and the next image, the next frame. So that would be your time step. You don't get new input until it gives you a new image. It has to do its processing, whatever. It has to wait for the vertical blank of the CRT to come back up, however your TV works, however your screen works. So there's your time step. The first frame you give the AI to work with would be 0. The next one would be 1. So if you're playing a game at 60 hertz, then time step 61 would be starting the second second. So that's what a time step is. It's just each time you evaluate the network, you give it inputs, you get outputs. That's on a time step. The next time step is the next time you give it inputs to get outputs. Capital T is how I've seen people refer to a terminal state. In chess, you might win, you might lose, or a stalemate might be called because it's getting late and everybody wants to go home. T is the time step where it's over. You get a final reward and you're done, and you go back to 0 in the next episode. It's so often called an episode. But it doesn't have to end. Your little coffee cup robot technically never ends. You could think of it going to sleep at night, being turned off and on as the end of an episode, but not really. It's a continuous thing. It's just every however many times per second it evaluates is just time step, time step, time step. So a terminal state happens when you have a game you can win or lose, or you have a goal that you reach and you say, all right, that's it. Now we're going to go back to the beginning. If it's infinity, then it's just a continuous process that never functionally ends. S is a state. It's your input. It's the environment. S is what your eyes see and your ears hear. It's what the robot's sensors read. It's what is on the board of a chess game, where the pieces are. S is the input. Whatever you decide this AI needs, what information you decide the AI needs to make a decision, is your state. It's also called a feature vector or an input vector. Your state in a chess game is where the pieces are. Your state in your coffee collecting robot is its battery level, its current position and velocity, whatever visual sensors it has trying to find coffee cups, that sort of thing. For a video game, your state is the picture. And you could have memory as well. An AI can have memory. Like I said, it just wraps around. You've got inputs and you've got outputs, but then you could have memory in here. So you calculate and you set this value is remembering something that's happened, remembering something that came in on the input, remembering an action you took, whatever. But it's an output that goes back into the input. Conceptually, it's like this. Don't think of memory as something special. Memory is just an output that goes back as an input. These outputs go to you, the user, the controller of the AI. These outputs go to itself, outputting to its own input. That's all it is. Don't overcomplicate it. Memory is just a circular output to input. So that's what the state is. It's the inputs. Inputs from the user, inputs from sensors, inputs from memory. At time step t, that's all that means, or t plus 1. The subscript just means, is it the first state, the second state, the third state? The first input, the second input, the third input, that's all it is. State is your inputs. Action. Action is what you do. Action is your output. The output of the AI is numbers. And you look at those numbers, you interpret them however you want. And based on that interpretation, you set the reward. It's just numbers. It doesn't understand numbers. This AI doesn't understand its output. It has no idea what its output means. All it knows is its reward. So the output is interpreted by you. It's in a form that you decide. You might have a set of possible moves in chess, or buttons that you can press on a gamepad, and you pick the number that's highest, and that's the move you make. That could be. However you interpret it, the outputs are the action. At time step t, t plus 1, when you are in state t. So we are in state t. This is the current input. The AI is making a decision. Action at t is the action it takes based on state. It's the outputs it gives based on its input. State at t plus 1 is the state that results from taking this action. And action at t plus 1 is the action to take in the next state, the output to give in the next state. So that's how they're paired. State is the input, action is the output. So now that we know what states and actions are, inputs and outputs, what's the value? What is this? The value for any state t, action t. This is your score. This is how the AI internally represents the training, the rewards you have given it. The more rewarding this is during training, the higher the value. So the math looks for the highest value. So what is this value? You have a certain input. The AI doesn't decide this input. That's the world. That's what the opponent did. That's what's on the screen. You have your input. For any action, there's all the different actions it can take. For every single action, there's a different value. For this particular action that we're going to take, that we have decided to take, that it has decided to take, whatever, it has a value saying, well, this is what my input is. If I do this, then during training, it tended to be a good thing. If I make this move, if the pieces are here and I make this move, then I win more often than not. You know, moving a pawn is going to have a bigger value than moving a queen where it gets taken half the time. If the action is moving a queen into a certain spot and the opponent almost always immediately takes the queen when you do that, that's probably going to be penalized because losing a queen will often make you lose the game. Not necessarily. There's strategic trading of pieces, blah, 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 blah. But the idea is, here's the inputs, and then you can take a particular action from that. And if that action results in more reward over time, if during training, the user, the controller, the master of the AI, gave it rewards more often than not, then basically by taking this action in this state, the AI is setting itself up for success. It's predicting the future. It's saying, usually when I see this and do this, good things happen. That's what this means. Q is a representation of how good the future looks. If the opponent has their queen and you can take it, that doesn't mean you're going to win. But them losing their queen is usually a bad thing. It's usually a strong bad thing, especially if you still have yours. So that would have a higher value usually because the opponent is in a worse position. Their options are more limited. Their chance of winning overall is reduced. That's what the value is. You look at the actions you can take in a particular state, and each of them is going to have a value. And you might pick the one with the highest value. Or when you're training, you might explore, right? Because when you're training, the AI doesn't know anything yet. That's the thing about this Sarsa learning. There's no initialization. You don't take all these books of how to learn chess and shove it into the AI. You literally use random values. A lot of people use a Gaussian distribution. It doesn't matter. You initialize the AI, the neural network or whatever, literally randomly, just static noise. So it has all these ideas of what it should be doing that mean nothing whatsoever. And training fixes that. It's called bootstrapping, as in the colloquial phrase of pulling yourself up by your bootstraps, which I know is paradoxical, but anyway, the concept is there. It knows what it thinks it should do, and then you give it a reward during training, and it goes, oh, well, actually, that was better than I thought or worse than I thought, so it adjusts. So Q, the value, is the AI's prediction of the value of taking this action, of giving this output when there is this input. How do we choose the action to take? Recall earlier, your policy, in some universe that's a pi, the policy of state and value equals action. Policy is what you decide. You could decide that the AI will always take the highest valued action. This is what you do when you're done training. Once you've completed training, once your AI is ready to go out in the world and collect coffee cups or beat Bobby Fischer, your policy simply becomes, every time, it becomes always pick the highest Q, the Q value. Whatever it thinks is going to give it the most reward, do it. You sometimes see it called the epsilon greedy. Epsilon is just a number that indicates something called exploration or exploitation. Let's not worry about that right now. Put very simply, when you're done training and you're using your AI, it always picks the action for a particular state that seems to have the highest value, that gives it the greatest chance of long-term success. But remember, we initialize this randomly. All the neurons are miswired and we have to rewire them. So during learning, you're not going to take what it thinks is the highest valued option because it doesn't actually know that. It's meaningless. So instead, you'll pick a random option. It's called exploration. Basically, what happens if I press this button? What happens if I turn this knob? And as the AI is trained, as it's getting reward signals, it takes a random action, you see what happens, you give it a biscuit or a scolding, and it incorporates that, and you do it over and over and over and over and over and over, and this is why people buy Titan graphics cards and supercomputers, because it's number crunching. That's what a computer is, it's number crunching. You do a whole bunch of number crunching, and you train, 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 and it starts to get an idea of what the real values are from initial nonsense. So during training, the policy is to look around and see what you can discover, to challenge your preconceptions and try this instead of this. When your AI is done and out in the world, your policy is just do the thing that seems the best option at the time. So for any particular state that you're in, your input, you have your value function, such as it is and what there is of it. Based on the state you're in, you look at the value function for all the different actions you can take, all the different outputs you can give. And based on your policy of choose randomly or choose the best value, you choose your output based on your input using the values that are there. When your AI is running for real, this is the end. You interpret that output. All you've told the network is this output is good. You have given it a reward for the AI. All that your AI knows is this value, this output is good when it gets this input. It doesn't know what this output means. It only knows that you gave it a reward. You said, you told me this when I told you this. Excellent, good job. And so the AI learns every time, or at least more often, when you get this input, give this output. You encourage it. This is just a fancy way of saying that. And now I'm never going to use that again because it's just an important abstraction. I wanted you to know that when you're doing the math, if you're doing the mathematical proof for all this, then you're going to be using that pi and everything all the time. But for us, it's just saying, how do you decide which output to give? How does the AI decide which output to give? It's either pick the best value or pick randomly, depending on if you're training or not. So now we've had the S and A of Sarsa. Now for the R. We have R at T and backwards R at T. And I'm actually going to say T plus 1. Now, why backwards R? As far as I know, I'm the only person on the planet to use this notation. But the thing is, nobody really has a notation for this. Everybody just uses R to mean both. I decided to just flip the R backwards, which happens to be a Cyrillic letter, but anyway. I decided that it's important to make it clear whether I'm talking about a number that is literally given by the user specifically, here it is, in my hand onto you, or what the AI has decided it expects. The reward is a number. Positive is good, and not really positive, higher is better. You could give it all negative rewards, and it's going to choose the smallest negative reward. If you give it a minus 1, that's going to be better than giving it a minus 100. It's going to seek the minus 1. So it's not about what the number is, it's about the greater one. It's going to learn to maximize R over time, to choose the action that gives it the greatest chance of getting a bigger R over time. And you reinforce this during training by giving it the R. Remember how I said you initialize the AI randomly? It has an idea. There's not a void there. There's not null. It has math. It has values and weights and everything that make it think it knows. It always thinks it knows. Your reward is telling it if it's right or wrong. Basically, it uses that Q function, and it decides, I'm going to get this R. And it uses that to tell you, here you go, here's your output. And then you give it your actual reward. It chose the output to give you based on the R it thought you were going to give it. This is the R you actually give it. If they're different, then it knows. If you give it a higher R than it thought you were going to give it, then it's going to say, oh, I didn't expect that. That's great. Let me do that more in the future. If you give it a lower R than it thought you were going to give it, then it's going to say, well, I thought that was a good idea, but I guess not. So it's going to do it less in the future. That's the training. It has a value it thinks it's going to get, and this is the value you actually give it. They're exactly the same thing. It's just this is the value in its brain, so to speak, and this is the value you actually hand it. That's the only difference between them, and I guess that's why people don't bother to differentiate, but I think it's important. This only exists during training. You are there giving it rewards only during training. This is the thing that's always there. This is what it learns. It learns what rewards it has been given over time, and incorporates that into its own decision-making, deciding based on input what output to give you. Alpha was a learning rate. Alpha is from 0 to 1. 0 means it's not learning. It means you give it an input, you get an output, you give it a reward, but it ignores it. It does not change its own mathematical representation. It does not incorporate what you just did into it. You give the dog a biscuit, but it doesn't care. You slap the dog, it doesn't care. It just keeps using the same knowledge it already has. 1 means maximum learning. It means it doesn't care about anything else in the entire universe. You gave it a biscuit. That's the best thing. So in reality, 0 is when you're done training. There's no training. And something less than 1 is when you are training. You can use a learning rate of 1, think of it as 100% to 0%. A learning rate of 1 is the hammer, the elephant gun approach. It's violent almost. It obliterates everything the AI already thought it knew. Now, when you are first starting up your AI, when you're first training it, and you initialized everything randomly, it might be good to run with a maximal learning rate for a little bit, because everything it knows is wrong, everything it knows is nonsense. So for a little bit, you might want to just completely obliterate everything it thinks it knows, you know, and run that for a little while to kind of stabilize the inputs. If you run it like this, it'll never learn, because it's like, it'll never remember. It will never incorporate any nuance. It'll just be like, biscuit, biscuit, scolding, biscuit, scolding. And it's just going to skew wildly and flail and flap its arms. So after the beginning, you can do it for a little bit right at the start. And then you need to turn it down so it calms down. And so you give it a biscuit and it thinks, okay, well, that's good. But maybe what about 2 biscuits if I do this instead? It has to get a nice smooth learning. I'm hand waving a lot and anthropomorphizing. You get it. I'm trying to explain it, not do PhD level math here. The idea is that zero learning rate is you're not learning, you're done. Learning is done. One is maximal learning, go crazy. And something in between is how much you want to incorporate the new knowledge. And finally, this terrible thing that's supposed to be a gamma, this is your discount. This, furthermore, is a number from 0 to 1. This represents long-term to short-term valuation of reward. With long-term thinking, you can give up a reward now to get a reward later. Think about making an investment. Think about buying stocks or bonds or whatever. You are being penalized. You are losing money. You're losing access to your money. You give money away. That's negative, without a doubt. You should keep that money. But if you make a good decision by doing that, if you pick a good bond or whatever, later on, even with inflation, you're going to have more money. So you're worse off now, but you're better off later. So if you don't take immediate harm, like if you're starving to death, you're not going to go buy a bond. But if you have some cash in the bank, you might go buy a bond so that in 10 years, you'll have more money. That's short-term to long-term valuation. If your gamma is zero, a gamma of zero, 0% long-term reward concern, means all you care about is literally what just happened. It doesn't matter if you give up this biscuit and get 10 biscuits tomorrow. All you care about is this biscuit right this second. It completely disregards the entire future and says all I care about is right now. A gamma of one doesn't necessarily mean the same thing. In fact, you'd never have a gamma of one. A learning rate of one you can use temporarily and it won't destroy anything as long as you turn it down. A gamma of one will destroy everything. Basically, how do we define long-term reward? It could be RO plus R1 plus R2 plus R3 plus da-da-da for however long it goes. So your long-term reward is how much reward you get. That's literally what it is. If you get 800 reward here and 900 reward here, you're going to value the thing that gives you 900. But gamma is used to make this not run away. There's no specification of how long an episode is, and an episode could be infinite. Basically, you want to value long-term reward, but it has to be limited in some way, otherwise you're just going to get a number that your computer can't calculate. Now, in principle, if we're talking about just math, forget hardware, forget limitation, if you could store and work with numbers of infinite size, the pure math, you don't actually need a discount. I mean, you do if you want to say, I want immediate rewards. You can tune it, but you could make it as big as you want because the numbers get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, but you don't care about the magnitude of the numbers. You care about which one is higher. So if this one is 800 quadrillion and this one is 900 quadrillion, you're going to pick the 900 quadrillion. The thing is, the numbers are going to get too big for your computer to work with. That's the limitation. In the world of pure math, this is only a tuning factor to say, well, let's turn down our concern for the future and focus on the here and now. But since we're working with actual computers and actual hardware limitations, it's also a factor to control the magnitude that this gets to. And for example, we multiply it, R0 plus gamma times R1 plus gamma squared times R2 plus gamma 3 times R3. That's to the third. Oh my goodness. With this handwriting, I should be a doctor. So if gamma was 0.1, so this would be times 1, this would be times 0.1, this would be times 0.01, times 0.001, because 0.1 times 0.1 times 0.1 is 0.001. So you can see that by choosing the right gamma, when you are thinking about all your reward, this is bothering me too much. That's slightly less awful. When you are looking at the future, your numbers are under control. They're still having an impact. If this is 2, and over here it's 3, 0.1 times 2 is still less than 0.1 times 3, so you still have that magnitude there. You can still compare them, but the further into the future you get, the less significant it is, so your numbers just don't explode out of your computer register. And that's what all of those things mean. Now, let's go back to those equations with our newfound knowledge, and let me show you these things again. The value, state t, action t, equals the anticipated reward, t plus 1, plus your gamma, times the value of your future state, s, t plus 1, a, t plus 1. This equation represents the AI's perception of the value of taking a particular action in a particular state. The state at time step T is the input. Input from the sensors or whatever, that's the input. Remember how the policy is looking at the different actions, trying to decide which one to take, which output to give? This is the one the policy has picked, or is currently looking at if it's going through all of them. So your state is given, and it looks at actions in that state. The value for that is the reward it expects to get plus the future reward. So without the discount factor here, if this was just one, then all it's saying is it's this reward and all the other rewards I'm going to get. This is just, if T is 1, then T plus 1 is 2, so it's state 1, action 1. It expects to get reward at 2, and then state 2, action 2, it expects to get the reward at 3, so it's R2 plus, and this right here, this Q, is R3 plus, R4 plus, R5 plus, R6 plus, R7 plus everything. This is the reward for this action. This is all the rest in the future, which we discount. We have our gamma for a practical concern so that this doesn't add up to be infinite. So you have this input, and you give this output. You get a reward for doing so, and then you're in state plus 1, state T plus 1. As a result of taking this action in this state, as a result of giving this output when you receive this input, you have received this new input. That's what the plus one means, is you gave your output, and then this happened. This is cause, this is effect. T is cause, T plus one is effect. That's all that is. So this is another way to look at it. It's trying to maximize the Q. The R is just the sum of the rewards. The Q is just the sum of the rewards, R. R1 plus R2 plus R3, modified by the discount. That's all this value is. It's just a sum, a manipulated sum, of all the rewards it has ever received. Now, it's branching paths, you see. Like, if you make a move in chess, your opponent has multiple different moves. And then based on which move they made, you have another move you can make, and then based on that move, they have multiple different moves. So this is not literally every reward it has ever received. This is the rewards, the balanced sum, average, whatever, of rewards it has received by taking this action. This is why we use a smaller learning rate. This is why we use a little learning rate, because it's learning about one action at a time. There's all kinds of different actions it could have taken. There's all kinds of actions, or rather all kinds of different states that can result from taking that action. So you have to modify the math that determines this a little bit, a tiny bit. Otherwise, you're just going to unlearn things you just learned. That's why you learn very slowly, and you do it again and again and again and again. And you learn overall, over time, generally, when you do this from this, you get a higher this and a higher this. This reward is what's given as a direct result of doing this. If you're playing chess, R is going to be usually zero. Think about that. There's no reward for moving a piece because you haven't won or lost. The reward is winning. You plus one for winning, minus one for losing, or having a stalemate called. Or if you think stalemates aren't that bad, you might do minus one for a stalemate and minus 10 for a loss, or minus 100 for a loss, or whatever. So this is probably going to be 0000000000000 until the end, and you get a one. So what happens is, during training, it looks back a little bit, and that's the third equation I'm going to show you. Basically, it takes that one and starts percolating it back, you know, through that discount, through this discount. So in the previous step, it might be 0.9. To the previous step there, it might be 0.81. And it'll get smaller and smaller and smaller, but it'll still be there in some form, and this is that form. This is the long-term reward that it predicts. It's setting itself up for success, whether or not it actually attains it. I already went over the policy, the pi one. We know what that is. This is the real fun. This is training. What I just showed you is when you're done. This is the one single equation that you use to train your network. Your value, state T, action T, prime. This is the new one. This is your new value. You see what I mean? This is what we're changing it to. This is the update. So it's the current value modified. The current value plus. We're modifying it. Alpha times, this is our learning rate, the actual reward we receive associated with the next time step. We received it when we entered the new state. When we saw what the opponent did, we get new input. When we see the next frame of image the game gives us, you get a reward based on what happened. The user looks at what happened as a result of this action and says that was good or bad. So that's the reward. Plus, the discount, if I can write a stupid gamma of the future, state T plus 1, action T plus 1, and then down here minus the current value, again. Now first, This right here, should look very familiar. This right here. Just put that R backwards and you have exactly the same thing as before. The value is the immediate reward plus the discounted future reward. In this case, we're training it, so we're giving it an actual value. Whereas when we're evaluating it, it uses its predicted value, the value it thinks it'll get. If you want your dog to sit and you tell it to sit, and it raises its paw, it doesn't do that randomly. It does it because it thinks that's what you want. Or it's what it wants if it's a poorly obedient animal. So it thinks it's going to get rewarded. It thinks this is going to get it a biscuit. And it doesn't get a biscuit. And it is disappointed and it learns, oh, well, let's try something else. And eventually maybe you push down on its butt a little bit and it gets the idea. Oh, sit. Oh, biscuit. That's the point of giving an actual reward value versus the reward it thinks it's going to get. Training, you tell it. And then once it's learned, it knows. And there's the math. So it's the exact same thing. Right there is what I just explained. Is this. This here is this, except with a backwards R. Don't overcomplicate it. This is why I'm saying it. I told you, simple is not quick. I have explained the same thing like 9 different times now. I'm not trying to hammer it in. I'm trying to reinforce it. Haha. This top part is just the current value, except given the actual reward rather than what it thinks it got. And then we're subtracting the reward again. Well, let's look at what happens. What does this mean? What's alpha and gamma doing? Let's assume alpha equals zero. Alpha equals zero, the learning rate equals zero, means it's not learning. If alpha is zero, zero multiplied by all this, no matter what it is, it's zero. This is all gone. The only thing we're left with is the current value. The new value equals the current value. We don't change it. Alpha of zero, learning rate of zero, means we don't change the value at all. We're not learning. What if alpha equals 1. Alpha of 1 is the maximum learning rate. You don't do over 1, that's meaningless. Alpha of 1 is 100% learning. Well, if alpha is 1, then it's just 1 times all this, so ignore the alpha. So you have the current value plus this plus this plus this, or minus this. So it's this plus this plus this minus this. The thing minus itself is 0. So the current value, this is the only place the current value is. The current value is gone. All we're left with is the new value, 100%. It's the reward we actually received plus the discounted future reward that we expect. So what's really happening is this R. We have the expected that's encoded in the AI and the actual that we're giving it. An alpha of zero means it's going with this completely. It's sticking with the value that it expected and it doesn't care what actually just happened. If alpha is one, then it's going entirely with this. It's completely incorporating the reward it just got and deleting every trace of its expectation. And having alpha be something in between gives you a balance between these two. A balance between sticking with its expectations and going with the new value. And again, the reason that we want to do that at all, the reason we don't want to just use the new value, is because it's only learning about one thing at a time. It's in a particular state, and it takes an action. It's not taking them all, it's taking one of them. And as a result of that, all kinds of different things will happen. There's a million different parallel universes that it can experience, and it experiences one of them. So it has to learn about one action based on one result when there's a near infinite set of those results and a whole slew of actions. So that's why we do a tiny bit at a time. And you'll have to trust me that this works. If you do it a tiny bit at a time, if you tune alpha like a little knob, and yes, this is a field of active research. There's no magical formula for this. This is one thing people are studying with AI, with neural networks and everything. How you choose what are called meta variables or hyperparameters. Hyperparameters is the common term. How you choose hyperparameters like alpha and lambda is an active field of research. But what you can do is just tune it and see what happens. You can turn it up and you can see the network is not learning. Like you give it 10,000 games of chess with a particular alpha. And then you see, well, how's it doing now? Is it any good? And then you say, oh, well, you know, it's not really learning that well. Maybe let's turn it down. And then you train it a little more. And if it seems to be doing better, you let it go for a while. You know, you mess with it. So alpha just trades between expectation and reality, between what it thought it knew and what you just told it. And the reason for that is because we're only learning about one single outcome at a time, despite there being a horrendously huge number of them. So what about gamma? Well, like I said, gamma is just a damping factor. You can turn gamma down if you want to focus more on immediate rather than long-term rewards. That might be a thing you wanted to learn. You might want it to consider long-term reward, but only a little bit. Maybe you're training your AI to be more flashy and showy. You know, you're trying to have it do more bold and interesting moves rather than just maximize success. Sometimes success is boring. Sometimes success takes forever, but you get there. Sometimes the very slow, methodical path is the best one for getting the best result. But sometimes maybe you're willing to risk loss for more swag. So you can turn this down to focus on immediate swag. And then we also turn it down so that the numbers fit in our computer. That's another place where you have to treat it as a knob and turn it up and down. If you start getting errors and your math is throwing infinities at you, you need to turn that down. Or give it rewards of 1 and negative 1 instead of 10 million and negative 10 million. You know, that's just fiddle around with it. And believe it or not, that's it. You now know enough to make an AI. Without a neural network, of course, because I haven't talked about that. You would just basically write down your values. Now, you may not be convinced by this. You may not believe you can do this right now. So I'm going to do just a tiny little illustration. The fundamental thing is Q of STAT. What do you need? You just need a grid. Let's say you have tic-tac-toe, or it's also called knots and crosses on the other side of the Atlantic. So, you know, I might put an X here, and the opponent could put a zero circle there. I could do X here and circle here and X here and circle here. X here, I win. And I've gotten blue on my red. So what is the state? Very simply, it's you've got 9 squares. Any square can have an X, a circle, a tick or tack, a knot or cross, or nothing. So you've got 9 squares times each square can have 3 options. These are your states. So what you have is 729 possible states. So you could label them 0, 1, 2, 3, up to 728. So for example, let's say, here's your board. Let's say that this is state 0. We'll just call it 0. Let's put an X here. That'll be state 1. What if instead of an X, we have an O? Well, that could be state 2. What if instead of changing that square, we change this square? We put an X here. Well, I could say that's state 3. We could say that this is state 441. I'm picking random numbers. I'm probably wrong. Don't worry about it. You know, what if we had this state? This state could be 214. This state is invalid. This can't happen because somebody won. And that means you would stop making moves and you wouldn't get to this point. So there's invalid states, but we're keeping the math simple. We can just ignore those. They'll take up memory, but we don't have to do anything with them. They're just space. So imagine a table. 0, 1, 2, 3, however many. Rows. Remember how I said a spreadsheet program? You just have rows. So this over here is state. And it doesn't matter. T. It's not even state at T. It's just state. State at T could be 3. State at T could be 0. State at T could be whatever. These are just labels. You could call this blue, brown, black, whatever. These are labels for the state. State of T could be 79. If at T, you are in the 79th, or in this case, since we're starting at 0, the 80th row. This is a simple situation where you can just have, a computer doesn't have a problem with 700 some rows. You know, back in the day, you're talking about your Apple IIgs, might be able to handle it, I'm not sure. But back in the days where you had bytes of memory, you know, your ENIVAC, UNIVAC, your COBOL systems, your mainframes, you're not going to just have 729 rows and throw it around like nobody's business. But nowadays we have these huge computers with gigabytes of RAM, and so we can just have a table like this. So this is not a feature vector. This is not your inputs. Your inputs to your AI, it would not be this number. You're not specifically stating the state you're in. You're saying, okay, this input might be a 1 if there's an X, a minus 1 if there's a circle, and a 0 if there's nothing. So you could say the inputs might be, so there's a circle there, so it could be negative 1, and then here there's a 1, and then here there's nothing, so that's a 0, and then negative 1, 1, 0, whatever. So you would specify to your complex AI, probably with a neural network, your inputs in some way representing the actual positions on the board. But I'm trying to show you that you can do this right now. Right now, with no neural networks. You just have to have something that's simple enough that you can write it down. So open a spreadsheet and have 728 lines or whatever. Or make a simpler version of tic-tac-toe that's only 2x2. You know, just something small enough for you to work with whatever you're doing. If you're using a program like MATLAB and you can just have it crunch and you put in the formulas, then you can do the whole thing. If you're doing it on a sheet of paper, you're going to want to have a simple example. But the point is, your state is just a row in this spreadsheet of what's going on with the pieces. And then here, what's this? This is Q of 0, action 0. This is Q of 0, action 1. This is Q of 0, action 2. This is Q of 3, action 0. Do you see what I'm doing here? This is Q of 49, action 1. The row is which state you're in. The column is which action you take. The number here is your Q. This is how you can do it. Just, this is the tabular form. When you're taking this in an actual classroom and they start talking about tabular methods, it's this. Something simple. You do not need a neural network to make an AI to win at tic-tac-toe. And of course, winning means stalemate, but don't worry about the game. Any simple game like that, you don't need a neural network. In fact, the neural network is going to be worse because a neural network is designed for something incredibly complex, analyzing millions of pixels or fluid voltage values or something. It introduces additional unnecessary complexity that's going to make the results not quite as good. It'll be fine. It'll work just fine. But you don't need it. A computer can handle 700-some rows. So go get your favorite computer program or whatever. And remember those functions? The Q whatever prime equals the Q times the learning rate of reward and gamma, all that. That's it. You just put that math in your program. Boom. Reinforcement learning. All that a neural network does is allow us to do this when there's 800,000 million gajillion Googleplexes of rows, where there's no way to do this. If we could do this every time, we would. It would literally be better. But let's say that you have a robot that's trying to balance. It's trying to not fall over. Well, it can be here, it can be here, it can be here, it can be here, it can be here. There's no way to represent that, because you could say, I'm at 0 degrees, 5 degrees, 2 degrees, 1.1 degrees, 1.11 degrees, 1.01 degrees. There would be literally infinite rows, because there's infinite measurements. I mean, technically there's a maximum precision to your gyroscope or whatever, but you get the idea. A neural network is introduced into this as an additional tool for when the number of rows and columns becomes too insane. That's all it is. If you have enough rows that you can handle it with a computer, just do that. And you don't use a neural network. Now, what's A0, A1, A2? It's the same thing. You have your board, and you could say, action 0 is move here, action 1 is move here, action 3 is move here, whatever. The action to take is just where do you move. Now, if there's already a circle there, you can't put an X there. That's against the rules. Again, it's still going to be there, but you're going to ignore it. And I will illustrate this in much more detail when I actually do AI. When I make an AI, I'll walk you through step by step and show you how I'm accounting for illegal states. So we had our illegal state, where we had like this, and then an illegal move. So you can have an invalid S and an invalid A. You just ignore it. I'll show you practically how you do that, just so it doesn't trip you up, but all you do is ignore it. Your policy, remember, your policy is trying to choose which action to take based on which one gives it the highest Q. Well, it's just not going to consider invalid moves. It doesn't matter if the invalid move says it's got a 10 million reward. That's just a leftover from the initial random initialization. It doesn't matter. It's not even going to look, because it can't do that. So it doesn't matter what that value is, it's just going to ignore it. And the same for states. In reality, you're never going to enter an invalid state. You're never going to be in a chess situation, a chess game, and have two squares that have a white king on each of them. That literally can't happen. So it doesn't matter what the neural network or whatever would say for those values, or even your table here. It doesn't matter what the table says for this state. You're never looking at it. You're never checking the actions in this state to see which one you should use. You're never getting there anyway. So literally all you do is ignore it. It's, again, don't overcomplicate it. It would actually take more computation power. It's sad. It kind of is. But it would take more computation power and more memory to store the invalid rows and say, don't store that. If you have 10 states, but only 5 of them are valid, then you could store that in 5 spots, couldn't you? But how do you know which ones are invalid? How do you know which ones these are? You have to have a table saying this one is this one, this one is this one. Instead of doing that, you just have the 10 and don't use them. It's faster and easier. And that's where I'm going to stop, because I assert right now, you know everything you need to know to make an AI with Sarsa reinforcement learning with no neural network. You just have to have a problem that's small enough that you can do it in a spreadsheet or with some simple program that acts like a spreadsheet. If you don't believe me, please leave a comment. You can talk to me in the YouTube comments. You can talk to me on Discord. Either one is great. Tell me what I haven't explained, and I will be happy to do more videos on this. I'm doing videos anyway. It takes me forever to make a video sometimes. I know. It's been a couple weeks, at least, since I've made the last video. But there will be more, and they can be on elaborating this or other aspects of it if you need. You just have to tell me what I should explain and put more simply. Until then, I'll be seeing you.